Well, I'm glad that I'm here. And so glad that you're here, that you can come to know how wonderful and how glorious it is to serve the living God. And people don't understand it. They're walking around being led by demon spirits under the influence of the God of this world. And they think that they're just making their own choices through life and deciding on their own, when in reality, that is absolutely not true. What we get to decide is who we're going to serve. What we get to decide, what God has given us the privilege of deciding, is if we want to be free. Otherwise, under the tyranny of the powers of darkness, you get to decide nothing. You don't get to make any choices. He's just going to basically snatch you around, make you do whatever it is he wants to do through you, to ultimately mock God and destroy your soul in hell. The Father's opened up the doors. Hallelujah. Karabokia ramandese. Rebetiji raman and eapana. Sedemandili prevea. I'm glad I don't trust in uncertain riches. I'm glad I don't trust in houses. I'm glad I don't trust in bank accounts. I'm glad I don't trust in the stock market. Hallelujah. I'm glad I don't trust in the value of money. I'm glad I don't trust in my own ability to drive myself down the road and get myself back. I'm glad I get to put my trust in the Lord, who is the maker of the heaven and the earth. God is almighty, and we're about to find out that he's more than just a religious figure. He's more than just a religious figure. Father is going to come and speak for himself. Father is going to come with his mighty power and with the sovereign moving of his spirit. And everybody who's been seeking after him, all those who would not bend and bow to all the kinds of music that was ultimately those things that were redefining the gospel so that we could be attractive and fit in and popular and modified, be fixed within the certain framework of some religious ideology. Those people who faithfully pursued him and followed after him to know him, hungering and thirsting for all the things that the Word of God describes that we should have. God, when he comes with his power, with his sovereign movings, those people are the folks that spring up in the glory of his presence and begin to do those things on a greater level, hallelujah, that he's called us to do. There's so many people, I can see your mind, I can see what's going on. One eye's in doubt and the other eye's, cast a wishful, hopeful, desire upon that land. Oh, Papa wants to move by his spirit. You know, I kind of got ruined this afternoon because I pulled up that old tape from 1947 when William Branham was standing in a meeting. All of a sudden, a glorious light came up over top of his head, and some people snapped photos of it, and that was a big old thing. It was never meant for anybody to snap a photo of it anyways. It was just a reality of what happened. And then he began to take charge over sickness and disease, speak the word of God. And everybody in the place, the blind saw, the deaf heard, the crippled walked. It was one of the great kickoff meetings of what ultimately we call the latter rain revival, the great healing revival that went all the way into the mid-60s. This was the kickoff night. And as he was declaring, captured on audio tape, was the audible voice of God replying to him. And you can hear the people begin to roar as a wind. They're talking about the wind. They were overwhelmed by the wind. A wind was blowing people over. The mighty presence of the living God. God comes and sovereignly moves by his spirit. And people that are willing to go through the whole thing that goes down as we begin to walk out his word. All the challenges and all the persecution and all the abuse. When you lay hands on the sick and it doesn't seem like anybody gets healed. When you begin to speak with other tongues and interpretation of tongues and you're caught away in the glory and all the nonsense that doesn't understand such a relationship. But then all of a sudden, Father begins to move by his spirit. I'm telling you, anybody who's childlike, who will believe what God says and get all excited about it, will have the manifest power of God moving through them. That's the way every revival has ever taken place. People sit around and they idolize and glamorize revivals of the past. Those were came through people who just stood the test and did not bend, did not bow. They learned how to give thanks all the time, live in faith and live in praise. And through the process, they were purified, prepared unto every good work, and meet for the master's use. Just standing faithfully in his presence, doing what God said to do. Hallelujah. Not letting up, not backing down, faithfully speaking his word. Man, I tell you right now, if I lived in this world and I was trusting in governments, I'd be completely scared to death right now. After China, and China's got a military power that is very impressive. Russia's got a military power that is somewhat even more impressive. They've been doing military exercises together now for 10 years. They're very organized. We nothing in their sight. We live under the good graces of their unwillingness to invade. It's just the way it is, people. But the thing about it is, I don't care. I don't care what's going down. I'm going to tell you, the more bad stuff's going down, the more I'm going to shine. More darkness is going down, the more I'll radiate with the glory of God. More people in trouble get really needy, the more miracles and signs and wonders are going to take place. I live over here under the shadow of the Most High. I bide over here in the secret place. I've escaped the world system. I've escaped Babylon. I've escaped that realm of iniquity where Satan reigns supreme. I want nothing to do with him. I've been delivered by Jesus Christ, the King of Kings. Hallelujah. Listen, if you weren't here on Friday night, I really laid out what's got to happen before the tribulation will ever take place. And, I was raised in the house with a lot of prophets, a lot of great men of God. My mother grew up with a person called Finette Dake, who's daughter of Dake, who's a great prophetic teacher. There's a long list of them, not just Dake. He just became well known because of his annotated Bible. It's a lot of other people. So I've spent a lot of time in this, and still spend a lot of time in this. And so I just say that by way of saying, okay, I'm not giving you some kind of, cheap opinion. And I'm not giving you something that I thought up. I'm standing on high ground. Amen. Built upon, about 2,500 years worth of ministry. Yeah. I'm talking about since Daniel, because Daniel is the one who really kicked this off. And so we talk about how this past Friday night, we talked about the formation of the empire of the 10 kings. Now, that is my phrase. I've coined that phrase because I wanted to break away from all of the other phrases that had, meanings that I didn't want to elicit in people's thinking. Okay? And so the formation of the 10 kings has to happen before the seventh kingdom will arise, which is the kingdom, first part of the kingdom of the Antichrist. And that has to arise before there's an eighth kingdom. People say that they see the eighth kingdom in Isis. Don't believe it. It's not true. It's not even close. It's so far off the map. It's not, it's not even on the map. Okay? It's not even on the map. But what we do know is that there's going to come a world war, a great world war, because the 50 of those nations that are part of the 10 kingdoms that will form under 10 kings are sovereign nations like Germany, Spain, France, Portugal, Holland. They're not going to give up their power. Iran, Iraq, Syria, Morocco. They're not going to give up their power. Serbia, Bosnia, Greece, Turkey. They're not going to give up their power and form 10 kingdoms with 10 kings reigning over them. These are kingdoms steeped in thousands of years of tradition. And the only way this is going to happen is there's going to be a world war. But don't worry. Don't fear the arrow that flies by night, nor the pestilence that wastes by noonday. Hallelujah. 10,000 should fall by my, 1,000 should fall by my side, 10,000 by my right hand, but it will not come nigh me because I've made the Lord my habitation. These are the times where God's people begin to shine. This is when the whole nation begins to start praying again. They ain't not going to be any goosey-loosey loose living anymore. I tell you right now, there's going to be people going to be ducking and hiding, crying out and screaming, oh, God, have mercy. That's when I kick in. That's when you're supposed to be kicking in. If you know the Lord. Now, if you've been compromising and bowing to all kinds of music, you'll probably burn up. You'll be incinerated with everybody else. But if you didn't bow, you didn't bend, you stood faithful to God, when the fire starts heating up, all you're going to do is shine. You'll walk around in the midst of it, praising the Lord Jesus Christ. The Son of one like another, the Son of God, is going to be made manifest through your life. Hallelujah. I just want you, man, if you don't know how to give thanks and praise God and the little stuff you're going through, I'm telling you, it's like the prophet said, if you don't can't keep up with somebody walking, what are you going to do when it's time to keep up with the horses, you know? Man, if these still little wisp of nothing takes you out, goodness gracious, we want to help you tonight so you can learn how to make the Lord God your trust. Everything Father says is about bringing us into a place of trusting Him. Do you have a translation device? Do you have a translation device? Is there a translation devices over here? Huh? Okay, quickly. Those are already supposed to be set up. Did you start working on it when I mentioned it? Good thing. I'm just praising God for that. I don't want people, some folks can't understand English. What I got to say is important. So, I mean, people take care of the folks. Are they broke? Are you having to repair them back there or send out a special quick order? Well, then somebody set up a place to translate. Whatever it takes. I want people to be taken care of. You have to set it up in the back. You guys have to organize it. You know, it's like if I was up here just speaking in tongues the whole time. See, my biggest problem is I want to bring everybody along. I don't want to leave anybody out. I not only notice things in the natural. I look at everything. I watch everything. You know, people that hang around me, they'll notice that about me. I track stuff. I'm just constantly observing things. That's just the way God made me. And I get to observe things in your life spiritually, and I'm here to help you. I'm not here to insult you, upset you. I'm here to help you. I want to help you. You can't go, you know, doing a turtle on me when I'm trying to fix something. You know what that is? Just pull into your shell. And you don't want nobody touching you. Leave me alone, kind of thing. Listen, we love you, people. God loves you. Father sent His word. His word is like a rain from heaven. His word is like a rain from heaven. His word is like the rain from heaven. His word is the healing power. His word is spirit and life. His word is powerful. His word is creative. His word produces faith in those who will hear. If you can open up your heart tonight and hear, then the word of God will produce within your life all the wonderful blessings that God describes. You don't have to live fictional Christianity. You know? Don't really experience anything that goes, or very few things that go on in the Word. God wants you to experience it all. I want you to open up your Bibles with me, please, to Matthew. Hallelujah. Kata raboste kande oke maste ponderatani. Stoki reshato dimine keshte perikane shiplota. Malambate apokaraste perinea. The Spirit of the Lord will speak to you and declare to you those things that will change the outcome of your circumstances tonight and tomorrow. And not only will He declare those things that will change the outcome of your circumstances tonight and tomorrow, but He will declare those things, if you will hear them and receive them and do them, that will change the outcome of your eternity. The outcome of your eternity will be received into His presence with exceeding great joy and place a place of great reward in him. Even so, now at this time, if you will hearken unto the word of the Lord, then you will be established in those things which God has said. And then you'll understand what it means to overcome. And you'll understand what it means to abide in his glory. You'll understand what it means to be overwhelmed with the fire of his presence. You'll understand what it means to be continually touched by and influenced by and overwhelmed by the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him. Here in this place, God will show you how to understand what Satan is trying to do so that you can rise up and say no and be rather strengthened by the Holy Ghost in your inner being, in your inner man. Hallelujah. So that you can comprehend with all the saints, all the holy ones, what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth, and know the love of Christ which passes knowledge. Know the love that he has for you, for knowing and believing the love that God has for you. This is where all boldness is now established. This is where all faith is built up, so that you can know that whatever you ask, he hears you and he's going to answer you and he's going to bring these things to pass. Father's looking for a people that he can show all these wonderful things to, so that they may be filled with all the fullness of God. And he says unto you, now according to his power, now but according to the one who does exceedingly abundantly above all that you can think or ask, according to the power that is at work on the inside of you. I don't care tonight how messed up things have gotten for you. I don't care tonight how bad things have gotten in your spirit, or how things have gotten in your soul, or how things have gotten in your body. You come and recognize Jesus, and you recognize how much he passionately loves you, how you important to him, how important you are to him. And I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. He's going to give you a gift just by the asking. And when you ask for the gift, that's the drinking. And when you drink, it's a wellspring springing up on the inside of you, providing for you a power at work, a treasure chest that goes beyond all the wealth and all the riches. Hallelujah. Katara manjay, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Katabora sheke na bokina haste. Hallelujah. Would you like some more tongues and interpretations of tongues? Kida mongze kina kaya. Because if you sit around at it long enough, you will be easily taken and swept in the same inspiration of it. Because it's not a part of the thinking of your mind, but it's the quickening and the moving of the Holy Ghost on the inside of you. It bypasses anything that you have to think about. It takes away self-consciousness, hallelujah, and fills you with the presence and the mindfulness of the living God, hallelujah. You swept away by a river that inspires you to speak things, to sing things, to rap things, to declare things that have been a mystery from the foundation of the earth, but now from the foundation of the world, but now God has freely revealed them and made them known to us by his Holy Spirit, which he has given unto us. Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I tell you right now, you listen to me, the signs and the wonders of Jesus Christ are as rich and as real in his church today as they've ever been. The blind still see. The crippled still walk. The diseased are still cleansed. The skin disease all over their body, direct with pain and boils, instantly, miraculously cleansed and healed by the power that is in the name of Jesus. It's just that, unfortunately, very few people have been willing to stem the test and go ahead and continue to labor with him. Who we are laborers together with him, and he's about saving people and healing people and setting people free. And if we'll be laborers together with him of his husbandry and of his building, and we won't back down and we give ourselves completely to the work, oh, great things will be done. Amen. You know, I took a couple of preachers out a couple years ago, and I showed them some raw land, and I mean, it was rocky, ugly looking land and places. And I said, yeah, I'm going to put a greenhouse here. We'll have a fishery here, and we'll have horticulture here, and we'll have vertical and horizontal grow beds here. And I showed them all these other things, and just looking at me going, "You what? This is a lot of work. What are you talking about?" Oh, yeah, it's a lot of work, but you know what? Vision that somebody places their hand to in a diligent way, all of a sudden springs to life. You can go out there and see it right now. You can go out there and you can see a rushing stream flowing through an in-house a raceway that's inside of the greenhouse, a beautiful water blasting out, and it's filled with all kinds of trout. And we're getting all ready to do some other work that even beyond that, inside of a almost a 5,000 foot greenhouse. And you know what happens when you begin to take up the vision of the Word of God and you begin to apply yourself to it. Some people think that only the fivefold ministry, the apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers are fit to do this work or have the power or ability to do this work. No, they're just the only ones doing it. And you're not going to get anything until you start doing it. You're not going to grow in anything until you start doing it. You're not going to get skills in anything until you start doing it. And you know, I'm here to tell you tonight that if you'll just start interacting with God and believing with God, your whole house will be saved. You'll have all the good things of God in your body and all the good things of God in your life. And the beautiful thing is God lets us start with us. You know, and there's going to be all kinds of challenges that come along, you know, try to mess with that. You know, somebody gets sick and they feel like God somehow has forsaken them. He hasn't forsaken you. He's calling you up to a higher ground. He's calling you up to learn how to just stand there and watch what he'll do for you financially, and it just goes on and on. Hallelujah. Hey, Shekinah-Meah. Hey, come here. Hey, come here. Come here, Dominique. Come here. Come here. Just as you're walking towards me, the Lord's going to touch you. Hallelujah. You see that? Isn't that something? Isn't that amazing? Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that just crazy? You know, just walk right over here into the glory zone, you know. Because your little body is hurt. And I command it in the name of Jesus. I command all the pain go out of your body right now. Hallelujah. Sato Renaya. Kato Siponda Ishte. Put your hand right there where it hurts and watch what's going to happen. See this right there? See that? Hallelujah. Now in the name of Jesus Christ, I reverse all the ill effects of that accident that took place this morning. How you feeling now? Isn't that beautiful? Huh? Isn't that beautiful? Huh? Oh, I sat through the whole meeting and then Atokarishina Holly. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just everybody just stretch your hands towards Dominic. Let's like for you to make you a part of this. Hallelujah. Because you can then use Sarama. You can hook up with a healing anointing, you know. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We just now, she's healed. We just now moving past that and moving on into a blessing. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Isn't that good?
Yes.
Isn't that good? See, he's here. The living God is here. Spirit of the Lord is here. Huh? It doesn't take a whole lot of effort. All you gotta do is just get over in the things of the Spirit and just walk with God. And as you, every day you walk with him, it gets sweeter, it gets stronger, it gets better, it gets more glorious. Hallelujah. We used to sing a song. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Every day with Jesus, I love him more and more. Jesus saved and keeps me. And he's the one I'm living for. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Oh, wonderful, wonderful. Wonderful is his name, saving me, keeping me from all sin and pain. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hatakana esheto, hatekana no sheta paneya, hatekana no sheta poneya, haletushena ikipatora. Hallelujah. Father, thank you for the miracle anointing. Rest upon Dominique. How she goes up to just goes from house to house on the reservation. That
there is this, and immediately as Dominique begins to call out the name of Jesus Christ, suddenly signs and wonders and miracles begin to take place, and before you know it, the whole Indian reservation is filled with the fire and the glory of God, because Dominique came into this world. Hallelujah. Amen.
Hallelujah. Arabakate. Tommy, come on, sit right there by Aunt Nikki over there. Karamon Sherry. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You feel good? I think you feel great. I feel good. Hallelujah. See, sometimes when we see people,
immediately the Lord allow us to feel their pain. You know, he took upon himself our infirmities, and he was touched by our infirmities or our pain. He says if there's two or three that will be touched by that infirmity or by that pain or touch the infirmity of someone else, then that person will be healed. Well, sometimes people will come by me and I'll feel what they're going through. I'll understand if they're being tormented in their mind, or I'll feel if they're tormented in their pain. And immediately in that revelation, I have a faith that works that causes me to know that they are instantaneously going to get healed. This morning, Allie brought someone to church, and I just want to tell you about the flowing of the Holy Ghost, because you just flow. It's nothing that you predict in the future. You walk one step at a time. You just flow. You just enjoy worshiping and praising. Listen, if you can enjoy worshiping and praising God, you can learn every other dimension of flowing in the Spirit. And you're just enjoying His presence, not under pressure, don't have to do anything. You're just here to obey God. And what happens is the Spirit of the Lord gives us such inspiration. It's almost as though it's something that we know without being told. We just know it. We're certain of it. And Allie brought a person this morning, and evidently her daughter stayed at home because her daughter had a migraine headache. And so as soon as they told me that, I was looking for the person because I was ready to lay hands on them. I had the faith to lay hands on them, and they weren't there. And so because I was moving in such a faith to lay hands on them, that I couldn't go beyond that. I can't go beyond what God tells me or what God has inspired me with. I don't try to push beyond what I'm inspired with. Do you understand that? You don't try to push beyond that. You just go with it. I just stayed right there. I said, well, just give me your hands. And then as soon as you lay hands upon them, go home, lay hands upon her, she'll instantly be healed. She was watching on the web at that moment, and she was instantly healed just because of the signal, of the Wi-Fi signal. It's like the Wi-Fi signal carries the anointing upon us. It's just boom, right there into the ears. This is the same like laying hands on them, you know. It's amazing, you know. I can listen to some of the old preachers from long ago and just sit there listening to the tapes even. There's not even audio. I have 1.3 terabytes of all of the great preaching that has gone on since the early 40s. And I tell you, I can sit there and it's like I'm in the meeting. I'm telling you, it's like I'm there in the meeting. Praise God. Man, I tell you, I pray in the name of Jesus that you guys get so in love with the anointing, get so in love with the moving of the Holy Ghost, that you just want to be around God all the time, you know. And that there's some Father has made it so that we can be around Him all of the time. There's no way to connect with Him like His Word. Opening up the Word of God. And now it's not a religious exercise, but it's something that hunger and thirst has now caused you to do and lay hold of, and whoo, and you become so overwhelmed with His goodness and so overwhelmed with His glory, and then got all the availability of all the great preachers and ministers. You know, there's one guy I wish I could hear preach, and I got to wait till get to heaven to hear him minister, and it's Pop Seymour. They didn't have tapes around when he was around, but there's a lot of other folks that we do get to listen to minister. And some, like I would have loved to hear Wigglesworth preach. There's other men, women. I'd love to have heard Mariah Woodworth Eder preach. She had a special access into heaven. You know, she could go up into heaven. She went up into heaven lots of times. She was up in Denver, Colorado, and she was making a point in her meeting, and she went to heaven for 3 days. And people came from all over the United States of America. Psychologists, hypnotists, other people, that medical scientists, and to observe this woman that was standing like this, like I'm standing right now, basically. She's caught away into glory. And she was in heaven for 3 days visiting her children, because she had 6 children that died before she started preaching and before she moved into miracle anointing. And then 3 days later, she came back and took right up from the sentence that she left off on. Because the Lord makes us for signs and for wonders. If we start enjoying Him more than being so overwhelmed and burdened down and stressed out by all the cares of this life, Father's pleading with us. He says, constantly he's telling us, will you please turn your worry into peace and rest? Will you please turn your sadness into joy? Would you please come and turn in your poverty for riches? Ha! Will you please come in and turn in your sickness and disease for healing divine? Will you please be willing to lose your life so you can have mine? I think that some people think that this is a downgrade. This isn't a downgrade. Hallelujah. This is an upgrade right here. Hallelujah. Dendero Sande. It's upgrade. Break on the body. Have his life. You act like they're going to lose out on something. It's like a person in a prison. And there's somebody standing there with a key and telling them that they're going to unlock the door and that they've got a Rolls Royce waiting outside for them to take them to their palace. And they're acting like they got to give something up, you know. Ain't nobody giving nothing up here, man. Hallelujah. The Lord's given us great riches. Praise the name of Jesus. Ho tarasitan. Ha. Hu repete. Hu repete. Hu repete ishinompai. Be in doubt no longer. Be no longer tossed. Be no longer overwhelmed with the affairs of this life and the things of your own interest and of your own concern. But this day, in Jesus' mighty name, go ahead and step over into the realms of divine glory and understand that Father will take very good care of you. He will take better care of you than you've ever taken care of yourself. Oh, some of you have done quite well, but I'm going to tell you right now, Father can do a whole lot better. If you would just learn to be willing to just trust Him. Hallelujah. If you would just be willing to cast your cares upon Him because He cares for you. If you would be just willing to now step over into a place of receiving that which love supplies. Just knowing and believing the love that God has for you. God is love, and he that dwells in God's love, he that dwells in love dwells in God. People, I'm just telling you, you can't be upset with other folks and dwell in God. You can't be angry with other people, unforgiving, carrying offense around, have all these problems, be all weighed down, burdened down, and experience the goodness of God. But if you just begin to let the Spirit of the Lord minister to you the good things of heaven. You let the Holy Spirit fill you up with love, joy, and peace. That's what He's here to supply. My, what a great line. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. We had this guy today just basically, we didn't know what he was doing on the road, whether he was going to intentionally run us over or run us off the road. And all I did was honk my horn at him, smile, and wave real big. And he's thinking, well, I didn't know I knew that person. So I left him in shock for a little while because he thought he was trying to run somebody off the road that he knew. I tell you, just blessing people and having the upper hand of walking in the love and the mercies of God, walking in peace, being the adult in every situation. Hallelujah. Being a spiritual mature person in every situation. Well, bless you. Amen. Amen. So I want you to open up your Bibles with me to Matthew chapter. You're feeling good. Thank you, Jesus. No more pain. Thank you, Jesus. Sometimes it gets pretty rough ministering to the kids. Huh? They get a little wild and start running around, do some crazy things. But I just praise the Lord for everybody who labors ministering with the children. Children, hallelujah. It's a special ministry. Hallelujah. Barobotos. To lead and to guide by example. You minister to children more by leading them, by guiding them, than anything that you say. Hallelujah. You just by loving on them and caring for them, praise the name of Jesus. They watch you. Kids learn through watching. They learn through listening. If you set your child down, imagine this. You set your child down, and now you're going to teach them how to speak human. You know what I'm saying? You're going to teach them how to speak English, right? It ain't going to work. You're going to be so frustrated. They're going to be frustrated. You're going to feel like a failure. They're going to feel like a failure. They just learn how they learn. Huh? You let them grow. Huh? They just listen to you. Before long, they're going to talk just like you. Guess what else they're going to do? Act just like you, too. Some people trying to think they hiding what they doing at home. No, I just watch your kids. Because they just going to be real transparent about everything. They're just going to be who they are. They're going to be what they've learned to be in your house. And I pray that they learn how to be people of the Spirit, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Some people go, uh-oh. Well, thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, I just thank you for causing there to be hearing ears, listening ears. I thank you, Father, that you miraculously produce the hungry heart. You know, we see the landscape of humanity right now, and especially in the Western world in America, we can easily become overwhelmed with the situation. Oh, no, what are we going to do? How are we going to advance the situation? But people got to understand, God's still God. God is Almighty God. And he's got the program well in hand. He's just looking at some folks. He's just looking and sorting out some folks who's going to go all the way with him. People look to this and they look to that and they look to Apollos and, you know, they look to Paul and they look to Cephas and they look to somebody else. But I'm going to tell you right now, if you learn how to look upon the Lord Jesus Christ and just stay right there in this wonderful program that he's brought you and I into by the Spirit, you're going to find yourself living out this glorious life of sonship, which Father is so desperate and earnest to bring to pass in our life. Just think about this. Father wants to reveal his Son in you. He wants to reveal Christ Jesus without all of your efforts. Listen, without all of your, with all of your trying to make yourself better, you know, without going through your own personalized, tailor-made 12-step program that you created. Okay? The Lord's just looking for some people that will stand in his presence and let him fill them. He created us anew by a miracle. He made us a new creation. By a miracle, gave us a new heart, a new spirit. All by the simple act of us being willing to recognize who he is and the gift that he had to give. And I'm going to tell you right now, he does the same. He does all the rest of it in the same way. All we've got to do is be willing to grow. All we've got to do is be willing to participate. Just be in the meeting. Come stand in the meeting. Come lift your hands. Come praise. Maybe some people that start off with it, they started dancing like some of us, they'd fall over dead with a heart attack. They're going to have to grow in faith for a little while, you know. They're going to have to understand that one of the biggest breakthroughs with all of the concerns and issues of life that press against them is just they haven't learned how to dance. They haven't learned how to just dance and praise the Lord. That's their whole problem. They just constantly get wrapped up in stuff. And then it takes them, and it's like a big spiral, and they keep spiraling down. Some discouragement, some disappointment, something didn't work out, some offense, some issue, huh? Man, when you get offenses or issues or things don't work out, you need to learn how to praise and give thanks. You need to learn how to dance around in the Holy Ghost and say it didn't matter anyways. All things are working together, for good to me on my behalf by Father himself, because I'm his. I belong to him, and he's orchestrating the situation. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Sickness start coming out against your body. You got to learn how to shout better. That's your whole problem. All people have these colds and respiratory problems because they don't know how to shout right. I said you don't know how to shout right. That's why I don't have them, because I learned how to shout right. I learned how to live in divine health. Did it all come in overnight? No, first of all, I had to believe that there was divine health was available. That you could live healthy, didn't have to wait and get sick before you could get touched by the Lord. You could get touched up front. Amen. Hallelujah. People believe if they have a good vitamin program and minerals and whatnot, that they can have preventative medicine. Well, that may be true, but I got some better preventative medicine. Hallelujah. Carrot juice is just going to go so far for you, I tell you right now. But the Spirit of the Lord, the presence of the living God, hallelujah, the bubble up, halapurashena mongatana, halemereshinota. And I just have to say this because I hit on it. Yes, people, you need to eat healthy. I mean, you live on the opposite end of this gigantic mass food producer that's spitting out all kinds of toxins. I mean, my goodness, you're just going to have to try to navigate through all of that. My papa taught me at an early age how to pray over food, bad food, pray over it and just say, Father, we just thank you right now that you take all the toxin and poison out. Amen. And that you put all the vitamins and the good minerals in Jesus' mighty name, and had faith. It was just like, it really is. This is like miracle, faith, And it's transubstance, Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for health. Harabokia. Thank you, Lord, that you teach people how to shout. Daniel had a great walk with God. I love studying Daniel. I don't know, probably studied the book of Daniel more than any other book in the Bible. I've never fully memorized Daniel. as I have other books of the Bible, but I probably studied it a whole lot more. And it's just amazing his relationship that he had with the Lord. And he didn't have half of what, he didn't have a fraction of what we have available to him. But he learned how, through just kneeling down and lifting his hands and praising God and giving thanks. People need to learn how to praise and give thanks. He was all carrying the burden of it all, or just all under the load of it all. And just, you know, and they just wondering what's why, you know, what and why and how. And you just need to get out of all of that. Get over here into the good word of God and start living by faith instead of your own perceptions. And the only way that you can live by faith is to live by the word of God, because we look on those things which are unseen. In other words, we respond to that which is unseen. We don't respond to that which is seen, because that which is seen is temporal, but that which is unseen is eternal. Those are the things that are going on right now in the realms of heaven. Father has... for his own good reasons, chose to take all that he has and leave it in the invisible for now. But I'm telling you, you walk with him and it becomes visible. Ooh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. You walk with him and the invisible becomes visible. Your eyes will be open, as it were, for the servant of Elisha. Hallelujah. Elisha didn't need his eyes open because he lived in the realm. You know, and when we hear about all of these men, Daniel, Elisha, Elijah, Moses, Enoch, all they are is their witnesses saying, hey, to all humanity, this realm really does exist. You know, it's an amazing place to be in, and look what you can do when you're in it, and look what happens if you just step over here. And many people just want to just relegate it to a story that is told and cast a wishful eye upon the land of greatness and glory. And no, step on in over here by the Spirit of the Lord. Understand that this very moment, at this very day, at this very time, you can begin to live in another realm called heavenly. At this very moment, at this very time, you can live in another realm called the realms of the Holy Ghost. At this very moment, at this very time, you can be seated in a place called heaven. You can find your citizenship there, empowered there. You'll have a whole new life to find for you there. Oh, it's going to be challenging. You're going to have all the Canaanites come out against you and say that you've got to do what they tell you. All the Canaanites, all of the moneyites, and all of the careites. Are you listening to me? All of your concernites and all of your desireites, and all of your own selfishites, you know, and your own willites, and all of them. You're gonna have to learn how to kill them. Amen. Because they're just standing in your way. Hallelujah. Hurabasteya. Anybody who will get excited about the things of the Lord, like a little child gets excited about good things and just jump right in because it looks fun, anybody who will do that, they will have the miracle. Anybody who will do that, they will be carried away into the glory. Hallelujah. It's the people that just got to sit back and they got to have proofs and they got to have evidences and they don't jump in right away. They watch first. You ain't going to ever get nothing. You know, basically, you're just a wet blanket at the party. You know what I'm saying to you? You know what? Huh? You're the guy or the gal who sits on the bank and, while everybody else is swimming and makes excuses about why you're not getting in the water. Huh? You didn't get in the water because you can't swim. You should have told somebody and they could have shown you. They could have taken you downstream a little ways where it was only about knee deep and you could have splashed around a little while, got comfortable, and worked your way on in, you know, to belly deep. Hallelujah. So you could just practice swimming, and if you started to sink, you could just stand right up real quick. Hallelujah. Tonight, I want you to just jump in. We want you to be able to jump into the things of the Spirit. We want you to leave. You have to leave behind your hurt. You have to leave behind your pain. You have to leave behind your doubt. You can't be of a doubtful mind anymore. You can't waver in your thinking. The Greek word is diakritos. And diakritos literally means to have two judgments or have two opinions. That is what we translate the word doubt. And of course, in James, most translations translated it wavering. It says, let not that man who wavers and has a double mind, two judgments, think that he's going to ever receive anything from God. Good news is God's not going to give up on you. He's going to work with you, and he's going to teach you how the correct mind. He's going to get you into the right mind. Amen. He's going to get you over here in the mind of Christ. Would anybody like to know how to step into the mind of Christ? Would you like to know how to step into the mind of Christ? Just start living the Word. That's it. Mind of Christ is just obeying God's Word. It's hearing His Word and doing His Word no matter what it costs you. And you just live there. You let the Word of God abide in your heart. Amen. You've overcome the wicked one because the Word of God abides in you. Just letting the Word of Christ dwell in you richly is right alongside of being filled with the Spirit. You know what's going to happen when you let the Word of Christ dwell in you? And you be filled with the Spirit. You know what's going to happen? You're going to walk around whistling. Singing and making melody in your heart with psalms and hymns, Tora Basareya, and a spiritual song. Giving thanks always for all things. Yeah. Come on. You know, if I could just get people to this, if I could get the church, if I could get people, anyone who wants to learn how to walk in the Spirit, to obey that one verse of Scripture on a consistent basis, your whole life would be changed. I said your whole life would be changed. People all trying to come up and invent all these crazy ideas and notions about all the things that they think they got to do. Listen, it's just real simple. Just obey God. Get happy. Just get all happy in these things of the Spirit. Just in these, in Horebasateya, and the Bondrea, and the Tano, and the Begit, the Moshikinitia. And to be happy in the things of the Spirit, of course, you've got to believe first. Huh? Now, I'm going to tell you something tonight that is absolutely truth. And you could say it's a high water mark. I say it's a pretty much a good starting line mark. And what I'm getting ready to tell you here and minister to you out of Matthew chapter 21:21. And I'm going to tell you that if you give yourself to these things, see, God is the one who produces it. God is the one who gives grace. Everybody here today, tonight, you have what you have in God because of God's grace. You have your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life because of God's grace, and you responded to God's grace, and you participated with God's grace, and so your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And I'm going to tell you, that should make you more excited than anything on. That should just absolutely eclipse and make really of no value any bad thing that's going on. Just that, just by itself, nothing else. Just that by itself, nothing else. I don't need nothing else. Maybe you try to keep track of too many things, and your mind just don't work that well. Huh? So just forget about everything and just recognize, you know what? I got one thing to be happy. My name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and that's going to take care of every bad feeling. Everything doesn't even matter anymore. I'm just going to remember what God did for me. But He's got a whole list of things like that. Hallelujah. I mean, we can just begin to rejoice that we have tonight, and we're able to function tonight out of the realms of that which God, by His grace, by His power, gave to us. And those things that the Lord gives to us, now we've got to be found faithful with them. We've got to do something with them, because if we don't, if we're unfaithful with them, if we hide them in the earth, as it were, we're never going to prosper, we're never going to grow, we're never going to mature, okay? And if you just be faithful with God, fathers, you know, Paul says, I am what I am by the grace of God. He said, the grace of God was not bestowed upon me in vain, but I took it and I labored more than everybody with it. I've watched some of the people that God has anointed, and I've just been so amazed by them, because they just are tirelessly running after the things of the Spirit. And I think to myself, Father, you made the right choice. Should be no surprise, but I go ahead and just honor Him, because He usually does make the right choice. Hallelujah. And it's just basically somebody to get here and change the battery on time and fix everything, because everybody's busy and most of the burden falls on one or two people. So if you don't want to have those kinds of clips in the sound, find out something you can do to help those guys back there, and it'd be a blessing to them. That's just a commercial advertisement for you. But people, you know, I look and I say, Father, it's amazing you anointed the right person, because, man, they run wide open. Well, they are relentless. I mean, they're not lazy at all with the things that you gave them to do. And it's really that disposition that got them into that anointing in the first place. I want to find myself being more faithful of the things that Father has given me to do. Father has given you the ability to overcome sin. He's given you the ability to walk in joy and love. Be faithful with the grace. He's given you the ability to constantly drink from a river that flows forth from the throne of God. Enjoy. Hallelujah. Come on, man. Enjoy. Don't be distracted and caught away with the things that this world system would impose upon you, which is a satanic system. It's a Luciferian cult. People are shocked when I say that. Oh, yeah. And I say it with such terminology because I want to get people to recognize what it is that they're diddle-dallying around playing patty cake with, hopscotch in the morning with, or whatever, you know. Are you listening to me? Jump rope with, or whatever it is, game you like to play. So that you just understand, this isn't no part of no fellowship with that. You got better things to do anyways. Amen?
Amen.
So Matthew chapter 21, verse 21, Jesus said unto them, he says, he uses a word here that means, this is a faithful saying. Or, better way to say it, is this is the absolute truth. This word that he uses, they translate verily, he says, this is absolute truth. So just try to argue with God when he said this is the absolute truth. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
When God opens up something with the absolute truth, he's trying to get your attention. He said, you listen to me, this is the absolute truth. He said, I tell you, if anyone has faith and will not have two opinions, won't be double-minded, will not waver, will not have diakritos, two judgments, which is translated here doubt, you shall not only say that which I have said to this fig tree, but you shall also say unto the mountain. It doesn't, the Greek language doesn't say this mountain. It says the mountain. It uses a definite article. You should say unto the mountain, it's anyone. It's not talking about the one Mount of Olives, you know, Mount Olivet. We don't want Mount Olivet to be moved. We want that one to stay right there. It's just got some prophetic purposes in the future. You know what I'm saying to you? Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. You should say to the mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and all things whatsoever you ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive. And you know, that is such a radical statement. Everybody says, you know, theologians come along with a three-cylinder word, try to scare everybody and say it's a hyperbole, you know, and I just, you know, it's kind of an educated way of saying it's an exaggeration. It's a nicer way. You're not just coming right out and say it's an exaggeration. You're just using another word that's a synonym for it's God's exaggerating, a hyperbole, okay? It's not a hyperbole. The Lord's just saying, absolutely, listen, I'm telling you for certain that whatever you ask, and he uses an extreme example of something that just really doesn't make even a lot of sense. You say, what value is there in that, you know? Listen, the Lord is just saying, if you can move past the doubt and you can move past the unbelief, then you can step into a place in a relationship that whatever you ask the Father in prayer, he's going to do it. And then, of course, if you look over in Mark chapter 11 real quickly, the Lord Jesus says it more radically in some respects, in a little bit different context. But he says this. He says, it really is pretty much the same context. He says, with absolute certainty, I'm telling you, you shall say unto the mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea. And if you will not waver in your heart, be two opinions, will not doubt, but will believe those things which you said, you believe that which you said will come to pass, then whatever you say, you're going to have it. Then look at that. If you'll just believe those things which you say, that they're going to come to pass, then whatever it was that you said, it shall happen. Therefore, I tell you, what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you shall have them. Now, I want to tell you that this is the place where faith begins to develop, and where faith begins to grow, and where faith is challenged. This is the place that Father wants us to go ahead and participate and begin to labor with him in a realm to where that all of a sudden we find ourselves maturing into the full manifestation of that which he wants for our lives. See, God doesn't want for us to live as mere men. He doesn't just want us to live as just, you know, people that are covenant people with him, and we go to church and we're good to everybody and we smile all the time and we never steal or or lie or anything. Father wants us to represent His glory. He wants us to step over into the authority of heaven and just go command Satan to go back into darkness, into the abyss, and just whatever else, man. Run the powers of darkness off people's lives. And that's why He said, you can't be my witnesses until you're endued with my power. And I've got it set up so you can have a party and get endued with my power. I'm going to get you a rushing mighty wind program put together. You talk about a special light show. I'm going to have some clothes and tongues of fire come rest on every one of you. You know, a dear friend of mine said to me the other day, yesterday, he said, most of these people, he said, he's been in the ministry for many years. He's in his 70s. He's been with all those famous preachers that you know of that's existed since the 40s. And he says, and most churches don't even need Jesus. They got a great worship team. And they got everything going for them. In fact, I don't even think Jesus would want to come there, because they're just so busy with their little religious program. But what happens when we're not busy with our religious program? What happens when we're desperate and we're hungry for the things of God, and we're willing to begin to allow what Father has described for us to become the most important things in our life? I mean, come on, be with thinking about it. Just think about it with me. Wouldn't you like to live in a place of authority where you're in charge of the situations about you, where that no evil thing, no powers of darkness, no wicked thing, no disease, no sickness, no tormenting evil spirit is able to come torment you and harass you? You have total power and authority over it. Huh? You run off sickness just by going boo. Huh? No, I'm not kidding you. Oh, we were standing in Kathmandu in a place that, listen to me. This is a place that no one else has ever stood. And I'm not saying it because I'm trying to brag on me. I'm bragging on God. This is a place that no one has ever stood. And everybody said it would be forever impossible to stand there, because Kathmandu in the nation of Nepal is the icon of the kingdom of Hinduism. But there is another more specific icon of the kingdom of Hinduism, and it is their national stadium in Kathmandu. And everyone said, it is impossible. It will never happen. There's no way. We stood for 3 days in the stadium in Kathmandu with multitudes of people. On the last day, the place was filled. It was, you know, estimated 30, 40,000 people in the place. When Ann and I went up to the platform on that miracle day, and something happened that everyone said could not happen. I mean, the person who's the longest missionary in Nepal, a wonderful man of God, he was the chairman of it, and he backed out after just a couple of weeks because he said, you know, it was going to hurt the reputation, because it wasn't going to be something that was going to be good, because, you know, it's a big, huge stadium, and he didn't expect that any more than 4,000 or 5,000 people at the most could get there. And we walked out there that day, with the Maoists telling us they're going to kill us and they're going to kill everybody with us and every one of the threats and all the stuff that goes down with that. Ann and I walked out onto the platform in Kathmandu, in the stadium in Kathmandu, in the kingdom, an icon of Hinduism. And all we did was say, hello. And when I said hello, they had been praying music for well over an hour. And it was anointed music. I was so blessed. It was anointed music, and nothing was really going on. It was all pretty much normal. It was packed out on that big, huge athletic soccer field with people, and then a good portion of the bleachers that first night was filled up. And all we did is we walk out and we said hello. And as soon as I said hello, demon spirits started going out of people by the multitudes. They was flying all around, screaming, wailing, people running with the powers of darkness manifesting through them, other people trying to hold them. Just mass deliverance with just a hello. That's why I said, you get to a place to walk with God and obey God, you just say, boo, and the things will leave. I mean, you know, you live in and you are, you just, you know, are saturated with the very name and power and person of Jesus. Hallelujah. By the second night, they brought the ambulance in with people from the hospital, you know, beautiful things, people bringing folks on cots. And if you watch that, one of the things that is still so clear in my mind and so beautiful in my thinking, here even here tonight, and you can look on that video that we have on our website, and you'll see that they're bringing a woman on a sheet. There's four bearing, carrying her on a sheet. And they took her and they put her in a tent where it just said, just take all the really bad sick people and put them over there in the tent. You know, I kind of do it like Oral Roberts did it kind of thing, you know. And just to kind of organize just the really bad ones over there. And so I went walking by the tent. I went walking by the tent to go up to the platform to minister. And as I was walking by, it's like that when the Holy Ghost wants to get your attention, it's like a tractor beam. You can try to pull away from it, but it won't work. He'll pull you right back around. The Lord's pulled me around the tent. There's that lady there on that cot. It was just so easy. Just walked over and touched her and said, Jesus' name be made whole. And she walked for the first time in many years. Her little legs were just so frail and so skinny. And hallelujah. I just love to see how beautiful, how easy it is, you know. It's just such a glorious thing. We were in in another town in the same meetings in Kawasuti, and they came to me and they said, is there a doctor with you on your team? I said, yeah, I'm a doctor. And of course, I didn't tell them what kind of doctor. I'm the doc right over here. Yeah. And the big doc's with me. Hallelujah. And the doctor of all things lives on the inside of me. I didn't tell them all that. Said a girl's in a coma, and her breathing slowed way down. They're really concerned for her life. And I said, yeah, I'll come and help. We walked over there. I just walked over to her, and I just looked at her, and she's in this coma, been in this coma for days. And I said, hey, sweetie, wake up. And her eyes immediately opened, and they're going all over the place because she didn't know where she was. Because when she went into the coma, she was somewhere in a village 200-300 miles away. And now she's here in this place. And it was so beautiful, man. She immediately sets up because she's like, you know, she's a little overwhelmed and shocked. I just love to see, isn't that beautiful to just see the power of God being really easily manifested in our lives? And these are things that happen all the time. The Lord touched you this morning, right? You had a migraine headache. The Lord just touched you. This is the president said the Lord. It's just so easy. You get over here, enjoy being with him. And he satisfies our soul with everything that all mankind looks for. He satisfies our soul with the sweetness of his presence. He satisfies our soul with the richness of his joy and the richness of his abundant life so that we have need of nothing. Satan comes along and tries to give to us some of his cheap tricks and cheap thrills, and we just simply say, we have none of it. We want none of it. Well, you got to be kidding me, man. I'm over here in life. Are you trying to sell me death? I'm over here eating at the king's table. And you trying to sell me that rat food? Give me a break, man. I want none of it. I desire none of it. I mean, if I could just get God's people over here and enjoying the good things of his life. Oh, harebeshito ronota. Hallelujah. Just become the reto messiah. This place where the wellspring springs up on the inside of you continually, where the rivers are flowing out. Father, as this is for everyone. Somebody said, oh, you know, that's just for the priest. No, it's not just for the priest or the preacher. These things are for anybody who believes. He said, anyone who believes. You know, when we look in John chapter 14 and verse 12, Jesus said, if anyone believes, anyone, at any place, at any time, these works which I do, shall you do also, and greater works than these. And you know what is the most wonderful thing to me about that? It is those works that Jesus did is a testimony of the relationship that he had with the Father. Whew. Hallelujah. It's the testimony of his intimacy and of his walk, of being able to see the Father and interact with the Father and hear the Father speak. To hear the audible voice of God. It's going to happen again. Amen. In 1947, it was actually recorded, caught on tape, the audible voice of God in a meeting. True. The audible voice of God. As William Branham is standing there declaring, commanding Satan to leave every sick and diseased body. We saw the works of Jesus through William Branham and through the people who moved in the gifts of the Spirit, 1947, 1948, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, all the way up into the mid-60s, such great signs and wonders. And they were talking about that there was going to come a great move, a greater move of God, where people were going to begin to do even the greater works. It would become commonplace as the works of Jesus Christ had become commonplace, that the greater works would become commonplace. I'm going to tell you right now, you will have no risk of the greater works becoming commonplace if you're not willing to come into this relationship and begin to believe that whatever you ask the Father, He will do. If you're not willing to give yourself to understanding that when you ask Father, He's going to do it. Now listen, there may be things that He's got to arrange. There may be things that He's got to work out. There may be things that He needs to set in order. But you come to understand that His eyes are upon the righteous. Now, if you don't believe yourself to be righteous, then you're not even in the program. Because reality of it is the Word of God has been stolen from so many people's heart. They believe that there's none righteous, no, not one, that we're all sinners. And that is the biggest heresy and the biggest lie that has been told since 2,000 years. For 2,000 years. When the very fundamental nature of salvation is that you confess with your mouth and you believe in your heart unto righteousness. Huh? Amen. For with the mouth confession is made unto salvation, and with the heart man believes unto righteousness. God gave us the gift of righteousness, and He gave us the gift of holiness, so that we have now the righteousness of God. Hallelujah. We don't self-justify. I'm not a sinner. I am a saint. Paul wrote everything in the Scripture to the saints. He called God's people saints. They're holy ones. Somebody said, well, Paul said that he was the chief of sinners. I mean, is that the only verse of Scripture that you know? Do you know all the hundreds of verses of Scripture that were Paul said that Jesus was fully manifested in His life? Do you know all the hundreds of verses of Scripture where He said that Christ dwells in Him? Do you know all the hundreds of verses of Scripture that are all about walking in the new covenant of righteousness and holiness and being a new creation and old things are passed away and behold, all things are new, and the sonship ministry of walking in the Holy Ghost and not fulfilling the lust of the flesh and being endued with Christ and giving no place to the devil? I mean, come on, you heard all about all of that? It's just insanity. It's just deception. And besides that, let me just tell you something. More of these lay preachers need to learn the Greek language, because there's three ways in which you can translate that verse of Scripture. Three ways that are equally provable to be as valid as the other. All three don't come out saying, I'm the chief of sinners. It comes out, I am first a sinner. And when it comes, if you want to line up the people who are sinners, I would be first in line, because I killed Stephen. I killed and persecuted the people in the church. I murdered them. I'm first in line. But was he calling himself a sinner? By no means. He knew who he was in God. And people have had their identity stripped away from them. So, you know what? You can't come into the presence of God unless you're walking in a place of holiness. Because His presence is holy, holy, holy. That's never changed. And so Satan wants to corrupt and defile people's minds so they can't come in. But if you take the blood of Jesus Christ, hallelujah, then all of a sudden you have conscience that's been purged of sin. Huh? You received a gift of holiness. Huh? Condemnation has been removed. All shame and guilt is gone. You in Him and He's in you. I mean, my goodness. Somebody said, no good thing is in me. Oh, really? You need to let Jesus come into your heart. You need to get saved. In me there is no good thing. Oh, you need to become the temple of the Holy Ghost, because He wants to come and fill you. I mean, it is amazing to me how we have drifted from the doctrines of God. And how many people buy into it, and they can only buy into it because they're trying to condone iniquity. As soon as you want to walk in the freedom which Christ Jesus Christ has paid for, that we might live in this glorious holy place, you won't be listening to that nonsense anymore. You'll be looking for what the cross did for you. You'll be looking for what the death, burial, and resurrection did for you. You'll understand that you crucified with Christ. Amen. And it wasn't a vicarious offering. That's, I am crucified. It's a miracle. Hallelujah. I'm buried with him by baptism into his death. Yeah. Woo! Yeah. How did that happen? Miracle! People ask me all the time, oh, how can this be about God? Because he's a miracle. Any more questions? Well, how can he done that? Because he's a miracle.
Yeah.
How can this happen? Because he's a miracle. Everything about God is a miracle. Is that so hard to understand? Hallelujah. He's not going to put fit in your little logical box and come out in your equations. Hallelujah. And I praise God for it. He's a miracle-working God who's worked a miracle for you and me. We were buried with him by baptism into his death. We've been raised up together with him. We're alive together with him and seated together with him in a heavenly place. And that isn't just some kind of doctrinal creed. That becomes a living reality. Huh? Because I wake up in the morning and I say, thank you, Lord Jesus, that I'm crucified with you. I'm not being crucified. What a miserable life. I'm crucified with you. Man, it's a done deal, man. You got to die before you can have a resurrection. Amen. I'm going to tell you right now. There are a lot of people just dying. And the Lord didn't ever say anything about dying. He said something about denying. And it's a little bit more painful. Huh? Dying. Well, it would be a good thing if the people had a doctor to die and they just go ahead and get it over with. I am crucified together with him. Proof, buried with him by baptism into his death. Am I making this up? No, I'm just quoting scripture. Hey? Huh? Come on now. Buried with him by baptism into his death. I'm really dead. I was just really dead in that sense. So that I could get a resurrection, so I'm raised up together with him. So that now I'm alive together with him. I wish I could hear more people talk about how they're living with Christ Jesus. How they're living in him. Hear these people about dying. And why don't you get it done, man? And let's get on with the program, man. We need to fill the ranks, okay, of the army. Why don't we just start talking about living in Christ Jesus? Why don't we start talking about put on the Lord Jesus Christ, therefore, and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lust. Hallelujah. Why don't we just get so excited about our complete and total deliverance, how he set us free. Now, I want you to understand that God, his purpose to have this kind of people that I just described here in Matthew 21:21, living in the earth in this generation, and he wants you to be one of them. And there is God's got a fast track program of living in the Spirit, walking in the Spirit. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. And being led by the Holy Ghost. I mean, just think about it. I'm being led by the Holy Ghost. I'm living in the Holy Ghost, and I'm walking in the Holy Ghost. That's pretty much Holy Ghost stuff right there. That sounds just like I'm living. That's Spirit life. Amen?
Amen.
I don't have time to do anything else. I wonder how successful he is at obeying God. I wonder how successful the Holy Ghost is at effectively dealing with doubt, unbelief, temptation, sin, iniquity, all the rest of the stuff that's bad that's going down. That causes, you know, all of this broken relationships. Family members who haven't talked to each other for years. All of the things that go on and the hurts and the pains of life. Just because you've not been willing to learn how to walk in the school of the Spirit. And learning how to love and forgive and humble yourself and lay down your life for others. I mean, this is a beautiful life the Lord wants to teach us, you know. And so, Father has brought us over into this relationship place. You know, he says in John 15:16, you can look at that. He says that he called us, that he chose us. Look at that. Isn't that pretty amazing? Isn't that pretty amazing? Doesn't it make you feel comfortable? Did you know you're here tonight because he chose you? Isn't that pretty good? Huh? That make you feel good? It's his plan. It's his program. You didn't choose him. He chose you. And guess what? He ordained you. And guess what he ordained you to do? To ask whatever you want, and he'll do it. So Father's got a program that he's going to make happen. He's the one who ordained it. He's the one who created it. He's the one who's going to bring it to pass. He's just looking for somebody who'll be faithful and stand with him so he can bring it to pass in their life. Anyway, somebody said, what does the faithful look like? It looks like you standing there being disappointed because you didn't get your way and still believe in God. It looks like you asking for something and it didn't seem to happen and you still just as confident in God as you've ever were. Huh? It seems it's just you standing there praising and giving thanks even if you're put in prison at midnight kind of thing. Hallelujah. People, I'm just dedicated to get folks to quit living like natural men, mere men, and start living this wonderful life of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Father, I thank you for this church. I thank you for a miracle church. I thank you, Father, for a bunch of people that are willing to let you till the ground of their life and produce the fruit that you want to produce. I thank you, Father, for the people that are here that are connected with you, that are really saying, Lord, I want your will. You know, Father says, not everyone that says, Lord, Lord. Listen, Lord, Lord is a, when Jesus said that in Matthew chapter 7, that, here's what that means. That means that he really is my Lord. Yeah. It's a doublet in the English, in the Greek language or a doublet in the Hebrew language. Yeah. Means he really is, he certainly is. I'm absolutely sure. Not everyone who says that the Lord is absolutely their Lord is coming in the kingdom. Rather, those who do the will of the Father, those who do the will of the Father. Jesus mentions the will of the Father over and again. So does Paul. So does Peter. So does John. We need to really pay attention to that. Will of the Father. You know, when you come to a place that you say, you know what, Father, I just want to do your will. Then you know what happens? You're going to be challenged with doing your will. And you're going to suddenly discover how much of the stuff on a daily basis, you decide out of your own will, out of the actions and thoughts of your own mind that you're going to choose for yourself, whether God likes it or not. And we don't even allow ourselves to process that much, but we need to. And if we will, everything will begin to take on the dynamics of the kingdom of God, of the heavenly, rather than the earthly and the hellacious, demonic realm that people are oppressed by and don't know how to get out of. Father wants to make you fit and equipped to deal with every temptation, to deal with all the wiles of the devil, to be more than a conqueror, to be more than an overcomer. All we have to do is be willing to participate. And I want you to look here with me in Romans chapter 8, because I want to talk about something that Father is laboring to bring to pass. Father is laboring to bring to pass people who will walk in the Spirit. And I want you to look here in Romans chapter 14. Paul says, as many as are led by the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Now, I want you to think about this. What an amazing opportunity. What an amazing opportunity, a chance, a privilege to actually be led by the Spirit of God. Think about this. Somebody said, oh, I wish I could have been Elijah. I wish I'd have been around with Moses. Man, I'd have been a Joshua or Caleb. You've probably been a, I'm not going to get into that. But at any rate, If you can't take advantage of what you have right now, you wouldn't take advantage of what was available then. There was a whole lot less available then. You listen to me. You know, back then you just had to shut up, sit down, and look, because you don't get to come in. Just be happy that you're in the number. You understand? Only one priest got to go in. Everybody else had to look. Are you looking, listening to me? Now we get to all come in. You could have drawn nigh. Just a couple of people were able to go up into the glory with God. Now, Papa says, come on in. I want you to think about this for a minute. I want you to think about how we've taken the things of the Spirit for granted. Why? Because it's like we haven't understood how to step into it. We called upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the day after got snared by religion. When Father's come to teach us to walk in a glory realm, you look at this. Here's what he's giving. He says, as many as are led by the Spirit of God. Think about it. He chose this. It's like you act like they got to earn it. You don't earn nothing, it's God. People like they got to work for it. Father's made it available to everyone. He's begging us. He's begging us. He says, they're the sons of God. Now look at it. I want you to just hang with me, hang with me, hang with me. Hang with me. I know it's a little bit hot. I'm going to get you a breakthrough over here.
Yeah,
I'm going to get you a breakthrough. Because I'm talking about you get into a place that whatever you say happens.
Yes.
Whatever you ask comes to pass. Now somebody said, well, I don't believe that. Well, then you know what? Don't even worry about it. Because you're not going to ever have a risk of having it right now. But you're going to actually have to bail out on what God chose you to do. He chose you to bring forth fruit, and that fruit would remain, that whatever you ask. The fruit, God's looking for a fruit. God, the Father, is looking for a fruit to come forth in the earth, and he's got a long suffering for it. He's very patient till it happens. It's a precious fruit of the earth that will only come when we begin to move into all that he has made available to us. And he calls this fruit, he says, this fruit that comes forth when it receives the early and the latter rain. Amen. It is the fully ripened fruit and developed fruit of the life of Christ Jesus that has been made available to us, so that you and I be walking around fully revealing and displaying the power and the love of God, showing that God has redeemed for himself a people from the darkness and from the sin and from the fall of Adam, who are now living in him and abiding in him. They're one with him, that have been resourced with all the inheritance that he has to give. That's not a witness for later. That's a witness for now. That's a light that's supposed to shine now. That's the light that Jesus shone brightly with. That's the light he said, you can't be my witnesses until you have it. Amen. We stand halting between two opinions. Double-minded. Epikratos. Of two judgments. Two opinions. It's about time we get sold out on God's got the good thing going on. And I want to move on into heaven. You know, son seems a little bit hard at first. But the Father's going to perfect something in our life because we're willing to respond to and interact with him in the unseen. He's going to reach into our lives that if we were able to see him with our eyes, he wouldn't be able to fully establish, because he's going to bring forth a people in him. He's going to bring forth an inheritance in him that will live in this new creation, in this resurrected body that's conformed in every way to his image, that is just like his glorious body. And there's never going to be a fall ever again. There's never going to be sin ever again. There's going to be a new heaven and new earth wherein dwells righteousness. And there's and you want to be there.
Yes.
You want to be fighting on the right side. You don't want to be accidentally throwing in with the powers of darkness while meantime you thought you were fighting on God's side. Listen to this. This is very important. He says, for you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear. Let me just tell you something, people. I watch folks come under condemnation, intimidation, insecurity, and so many other manifestations of fear. You're going to have to learn to cast that stuff down. You're going to have to learn a love of God that will cast out that fear. You're going to have to understand that that is a demonic ploy. Listen to me. Listen to me. Listen, hear me. The imaginations that go on in the mind, the thoughts that plague men. If people was really able to isolate all the variables and be able to fully understand, for example, addictions, by and large, all it is people oppressed by a continual thought and imagination of their mind. It's not even physiological. It's just totally oppressed by a thought and imagination in the mind, because that's the way that the powers of darkness operate anyways. Oh, but the weapons of our warfare are not carnal but mighty to cast down those things, to be able to bring every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ Jesus, to literally live in and practice living in the mind of Christ, the mind of the Spirit. Also, that's where the word of knowledge works, and it works so easily. You just walk along and boom, you see it. You didn't have to ask to see it. Just walk in the Spirit. You see it. You have the word of wisdom. You know what to do. You have the discerning of spirits. It's just there. You live in the realm. You live it in the life. It's not something you're going to have. Only thing you got to practice is obedience. Yes. Hallelujah. Can you hear me back there?
Yes.
All you got to do is practice obedience. All the rest of it just comes. You know, I like to teach the school of the Spirit. I do one usually a couple of times a month on Friday nights. And I don't usually talk to people about how to move into various different gifts. Basically, I just tell them about the things that will keep them from moving in the gifts. Because moving the gifts of the Spirit, once you've been born of the Spirit, is as natural as breathing. Hallelujah. Just hoorah bastaya. Now, but what he has given us, I want you to hear this, because this is the choice of the state and the disposition of our heart that is so important that you get sold out on that this is how you're going to live. He says, but we've received the spirit of sonship, whereby we say, God's my dad. Yeah. Say, I received
the spirit
of sonship.
Whereby
I say,
God is my papa.
That is a good one.
Yeah.
That's a very good one. And that is the absolute opposite of living in the bondage that fear will produce. Fear will produce a sense of condemnation, a sense of shame, a sense of separation. You're not good enough. Somehow you've got to earn it. Somehow you've got to prove to God that you're worthy of it. You're never going to get this. That's fear. That's bondage. You're never going to be able to flow in the beauty and the splendor of walking in the Holy Ghost and receiving freely all those things that He gives, and is recognizing that it's a gift that comes to you. It's available to you. All you've got to do is be willing to conform your attitudes, your emotions, your disposition to the things which the Spirit of the Lord has described in His Word and is supplying unto us on a daily basis as we interact with Him. Hallelujah. Now I'm going to try to hurry through this because I want to get to the practical application here in a minute.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to get to the point where some of you are just so raptured in the realms of this, of the Holy Ghost, that you can never find your way back to the human realm. Hallelujah. Ha ha ha. And when you find this place, hallelujah, you become a prisoner of heaven. Hallelujah. Ha 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 ha. Hallelujah. Become one of those that Jesus led captive. Hallelujah. He led captivity captive. Hallelujah. I'm the prisoner of the Lord Jesus Christ. Ha ha ha. I'm a servant. I'm a slave. I've been caught away in the good things of heaven. Now I obey the ruler of my soul, the master of my life, the sovereign Lord of lords. Amen.
Amen.
We want you to come into this beauty and this splendor. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And to where you wake up in the morning and you go, you mean I got all of this in heaven too? Days of heaven upon earth. Oh, people, wouldn't you love to be able to be delivered from your human slavery? To where you have to work so hard for a taskmaster, and you're never good enough, and you never make enough money, and you never feel right, and you always feel wrong, and there's so many things left undone. Wouldn't you love to be delivered from such slavery? Jesus came to liberate us. Hallelujah. Harapotoya. He came to set us free to now walk over in the place of an abundant life, being taken care of and provided for by our Heavenly Father, no longer seeking the things that the nations seek after or having our desire in this earth, but now seeking first and the kingdom of God and His righteousness, having our desires over in a whole nother realm. And so he says, the Holy Ghost Himself bears witness with our spirit that we're the children of God. And he says this. He says, if we're the children of God or sons of God, you know, those people who are now captivated by the Holy Ghost, then we're the heirs of God. Ooh, you got good things going on. You heir. Huh? You heir and you co-inherited with Jesus. Now just a minute. Oh, yeah, I believe I'm an heir, but I don't get to get any of the money. I don't get to get any of the wealth and the riches till Dad dies. All right? I don't get any of the wealth or any of the riches or any of the benefits until I come of age. And who knows when I'm going to come of age and what that looks like. Well, that would be a terrible quandary, wouldn't it? But just hold your finger right here and let me show you that you done come to age. Let me show you. Anybody who tonight would dare to believe God, anybody here tonight who would dare to believe God, who would dare to step out into the realms of the heavenly and the realms of the miraculous and the realms of that which Jesus described, has come of age. Anybody who stepped beyond the realms of that which the spirit of fear would try to imprison you with, hallelujah, Robota, take up arms against the Selfites and the Kerites. Amen. Hallelujah. You've come at age. Look in Galatians chapter 4 real quickly. You know, the Word of God's supposed to produce faith in you. It's supposed to describe to you what you can and cannot do. And I like to emphasize the things you can do. Hallelujah. And really understand that there's nothing you cannot do. Amen. Hallelujah. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do nothing of myself, but I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And it says, look at this now. So Paul makes the argument here. He said, now I say then, verse 1, that it is, if you're heir, as long as you're a child, you can't have any of it. Because even though you're a child, you differ nothing from a servant. You're same as a servant, even though you're the Lord of all. But you're under tutors and governors until you come of age, the appointed time. Even so, when you were the children in bondage, you were under the elements of the world. I'm asking you, are you living in fear? You living under the spirit of bondage and fear? Can't have any of it. Are you intimidated? Can't have none of it. You doubt and unbelieve? Can't have it. Can't have it. You're going to have to be taught how to just trust God. Come over here in a relationship. Get loved on. Be loved on. Are you listening to me here tonight? Verse 4, but when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his son, made of a woman, made under a law. Now he's already given to us the conditions by which, now that we're set free from that problem, because we don't know even how to get ourselves out of, we don't know how to work ourselves out of a wet paper bag. We don't know how to work, don't know how to do the very simplest things for our own self. Might as well give up. If there's anything left for us to do, it won't get done. So God did it all. And all we got to do is accept it. Is that a free gift? Is that a good plan or what? Yeah, all you and I got to do is obey and participate with what he's done for us.
Yes.
He said, I finished the work, now just come and enjoy. Come participate with it. Now listen to this. He says, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive sonship. You hear, you see that? Yes. That we might receive the sonship of sons. Now look at this, verse 6. And because you are sons. Remember that over there in Romans chapter 8? As many as are walking, being led by the Holy Ghost, they the sons. Are you with me? As many as are being led by the Spirit of God, they the sons of God. You are sons. And God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son inside of your heart. And you're not fearing because you're under the spirit of bondage, but you're saying, God's my papa. Say, God's my papa. And I just want you to understand that Paul's talking about the same subject here, isn't he? Isn't it obvious? By 3 points, it makes it obvious that he's talking about the exact same thing that he's saying in Romans chapter 8. Now look at this. And he says in verse 7, therefore, you are no more servants, you're no more like a child, but you are sons. You come to age. In other words, he's saying you matured enough to have all that Father's made available to you. He says, look at that right there. He says, if you sons, then you heirs of God through Christ. Therefore, everything that Father has is available. Therefore, when we talk about, oh, Holy Spirit is opened up tonight in Ephesians chapter 3 and 16. Strengthen me. Father, strengthen me. Father, we bow our knee before you, of whom every family in heaven and earth is named, that you would grant unto us that we might be strengthened with all might, with all divine power, with all divine ability in our inner being by the Holy Spirit. So that we can comprehend with all the holy ones, with all the saints, what is the height, the breadth, the depth, the length, to know the love of Christ. This love. Love casts out fear. Love frees you in this relationship now to begin to recognize who Dad is and what he's going to do for you and how he's there to hear and to answer every request. The lines of fellowship and communication are wide open now. Hallelujah. So that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now, unto him who's able to do superly abundantly. Super duperly abundantly. Above all that you can think or ask. According to the power that is at work on the inside of you. He's got a path. We want, oh God, in the heavens, come down. He's already done that. And he's already gone back. And now he's come to live and dwell and abide on the inside of us. I had a preacher say to me one time, he says, oh, the heavens are brass and I can't get any prayers through. I said, even if the heavens were brass, you wouldn't need to worry about it because Christ Jesus lives on the inside of you. God, the Holy Ghost living on the inside of you. So you don't have nothing to worry about. Forget about brass heavens. You got a direct line right where you're standing. You stepped into heaven. You living in heaven, didn't know it. You living in the land of glory and didn't know it. You living with all divine provision all about you and didn't even know it. All around you in the unseen realm that you can only behold through the eyes of faith, which is to say, through the eyes of that which God described in His Word. And now all you can see are the physical realms of the nothingness that you're holding on to. And your heart and your desires and your affections are all wrapped up in that stuff. You can never move forward. And God, you'll continue to live in a prison called fear. It's a prison called fear. It's a prison called fear. God loves you. He proved it through Christ Jesus. God loves you. The Spirit of the living God is pouring forth the love of God into your heart to show it, to prove it to you. Because this is where it's all got to be. This is the foundation of it all. I want you to go back real quickly to Romans chapter 8. Just stand with me. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Father, touch these people here tonight. Touch these people here tonight, Lord. Touch these people here tonight, Lord. Touch these people here tonight, Father. Father, I ask you in Jesus' name to cause every person in this place to be so built up in faith that they can go and conquer the world.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Every hindering power of darkness, a break of power right now in the name of Jesus. Every unholy thing in Jesus' name. You have no right of power to hinder God's people. In Jesus' name. You must leave the property of God alone. Hallelujah. 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 Roko shiataya. Arababa reseridi frati shikordiran. Hallelujah. 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 Kiri mama mandaya. Just be seated for just a few more minutes. Just lezerino shiate. Ur serena shibon romang shili. If there's anything that Father wants to do, is going to become so real to you. If there's anything that God is longing to do, that the Holy Spirit is longing to do, is to make Jesus so real to you, His presence so real to you. It's not something that you've got to beg God to do. This is that which He wants to do. Amen. He wants to touch your eyes so that you may see. He wants to touch your heart so that you may understand. He wants to cause you to be more aware, really, of the things that are going on in the realms which He occupies. We call the realms of the Spirit. Even then you are aware of the natural, to where that what Father has willed and what Father has purposed
is bigger to you than what you see before your eyes. So that if you see a person who's blind, the things of the will of the Father, that he would desire to open up the eyes of the blind, are more important to you. They're bigger to you than that state that you see before your physical eyes. And therefore, you're moved with a power and a faith and a passion that changes the dynamic. Goes that way. Goes down that way in every dimension of life. Oh, rebasta retiste pronosto. Men angliste pronosto ranekia shapurideia. There is no reason tonight that anyone in this place should leave here with any kind of sickness or disease. This should be an event for you tonight to where that whatever sickness or whatever disease or whatever plague has tried to afflict your body would no longer have any right or power or hold upon you. That you'd walk out of this place tonight having met with God. There's no reason that anything of the past should torment your mind. That the mind should be washed clean with the blood of Jesus Christ and with the water of the Word. So that everything about your life is holy and acceptable unto God. And you just feel the freedom of it and the love of it. Even when that is a state of your heart, let me just tell you this. Satan has very little chance of being able to enter into your life. It's only when you feel displaced. It's only when you feel like there's a distance between you and the Lord. Somehow you've failed and you've let God down. That Satan even has a chance to come and try to fill that void. Tonight we want you to know the riches of his love. Tonight we want you to be able to embrace all the good things that he has for you and live in them for the rest of your life. Which goes on and throughout eternity. Hallelujah. I'm just laboring to help you understand that Father, as the husbandman who is laboring in our lives to bring forth the fruit that he talked about in John chapter 15. He wants to bring forth the fruit of the glory and the beauty and the splendor of the life of the Spirit. He wants to bring forth the fruit of the very life of Jesus so that the world may have a witness of who loves them so much and who died for them and who fully paid the price for their sins so that they may go free from every torment, not only in this world, but also in the world to come. Father is laboring to find new people that will cooperate with them. And I want you to hear this, and that's why I just want you to spend just a few more minutes with me as I'm talking really about James chapter 5 and verse 7, but I'm back in Romans chapter 8. James 5, 7 is about Father saying, he's saying, have patience unto the coming of the Lord Jesus, because he's going to have a fruit first. I'm just giving it to you the way it's supposed to do, just a simple layman translation. Have patience unto the coming of the Lord Jesus, because Father's going to have his perfect fruit first. He's going to have the fullness of that glory and that power that was manifested in Christ Jesus being manifested in his people and in his church. He's going to have the witness in the earth. He's not going to leave the earth in the state of not having that witness. Hallelujah. Not just going to be one or two or three or four running around with the power and the glory of God being expressed in their life, but it's going to be everybody. The church is going to come alive. I wanted to kind of give an example of this. I just posted on my Facebook this afternoon two examples of the church coming alive. And there was a little boy. When I posted, the little boy was severe nervous disorder and couldn't just hold still. It was everywhere. You've seen little children like that, right? What is that diagnosed with? Where they go, huh? Yeah. It was some kind of palsy or central nervous system. I don't understand Spanish very well, but they began to pray with them. The little child was completely healed. He just stood there with his hands lifted up, his countenance of his face changed. And I've had another one where a little boy had not walked for over 10 years. I don't remember exactly what it was because it's all in Spanish. And the church began to pray, and the pastor just reached out and grabbed him by the hand, and he took his first step, and you saw him. He just began to sob, you know, he just scared. He's scared and overwhelmed and happy and thankful all at the same time. He just You know, it's beautiful to watch. It's the church. And it's just the smallest things, the church coming to life. Coming to life with the moving of the power of God. The glory of fellowship with Him that changes the dynamics of the atmosphere, that changes the whole, basis of reality. That suddenly brings us into something that's far better than the stuff that we've been laboring for that don't even count. I wanted to show you tonight that Father is laboring to bring this to pass, and if we'll dig with Him, if we'll plow with Him, if we'll plant with Him, when he begins to move sovereignly, we'll be right there in the place to begin to receive all that He and then would begin to download even on another level, because we were laboring together with Him. If we're just over in religion, we're not getting any of it. We can watch what happens, but it's not going to happen through us. And I want you just to be set here tonight that you're going to be a part of the glorious church. I mean, they're having a great moving of God in China right now, in different parts of Asia. Having a great moving of God in Africa right now, in South America, in Paraguay, and, Guadalajara, and other places in Mexico, just spotty, but they're having some great moves of God in Argentina, Brazil. It's time for North America to be shaken with the power of the Holy Ghost again. It's time. It's time. I was talking to my friend Don Clowers yesterday, and he's been close friends with most of the people that God raised up and used in mighty ways, and God used him in mighty ways. He's been all over the world preaching the gospel. He'll probably be here in November with us. I mean, he was with A.A. Allen. He was one of A.A. Allen's probably closest friends, other great men of God. And he said to me, Mark, he said, I've really been troubled deeply in my spirit because of the state of the church. But he said, over this past year, I've been so overwhelmed by the presence of God that it's been so difficult for me to just do my daily responsibility things, because I'm so captivated by His glory, just so caught away in the heavenly realm. He said, I stepped into a great peace. I know that there is getting ready to be another flood from heaven. It's getting ready to be another flood. See, Hosea chapter 6, verse 3 says He comes to us as the rain, as the early and the latter rain. That is the sovereign movings of God, so that you may see who will follow on to know Him. Oh, see, I've been in the moves of God, and I've continued to follow on to know Him. I haven't had all of the results that I've wanted to have in the United States of America, but I've just continued to follow on to know Him. I know that those things which God has spoken, He's certainly going to bring to pass. I know that all the promises of God are just as real today as the very moment that He spoke them. To me, Matthew chapter 21, verse 21, that I read to you just a little bit ago, of that verse of Scripture that seems so beyond the reality, it's just as though He just said it. He's saying again. He's declaring it again. He's not whispering either. He's shouting it out. Back in Romans chapter 8, real quickly, I'm going to just bypass all these verses of Scripture, and I wanted you to see something here quickly. In this context of being heirs of God, He says in verse 19, He says, for the earnest expectation of all creation. All creation, Paul is describing to us, has this eager expectation. It's like it's sitting on the edge of its seat waiting for the event to happen. They're gathered for the event, and it's as though the event's running a little bit late, but it's such an exciting event. They're sitting on the edge of their seat waiting for the event to take place. And he says that the eager expectation of creation is waiting to see the manifestation of these people that I just told you about that walk in the Spirit, who are heirs of God and co-inheritors of Jesus. Can you hear it? Can you see that? Turn me up.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yes.
I just feel like I ought to get louder. Can you hear me?
Yes.
People want to dichotomize this and separate this out. I'm going to tell you right now, Paul walked in the manifestation of the sons of God. He did. He said, when I suddenly discovered that God had purposed to reveal His Son in me, He said, I no longer conferred with flesh and blood. This is Galatians 1:16. But I immediately went out into the wilderness, into Arabia. And there I taught of the Lord for 3 years. You know what the Lord taught him? It's a new covenant. And he came back and wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. God taught him the new covenant. He taught him what it meant to walk in this new creation. He taught him what it meant to walk in this resurrected life, seated in the heavenly realm with a citizenship in heaven, being baptized in the Holy Ghost. Old things passed away and everything having become new. He taught him about how to step into the fullness of the measure, the maturity, the ministry of Jesus, even unto a fully matured man, having now been created anew in righteousness and true holiness. Man, he just taught some radical stuff. Hey? I mean, if I started telling you about everything that God taught him, you know, we started going through it, would be here till, you know, the rising of the sun in the morning, and I would still be going. That's how Paul preached anyways. Somebody says, why do we stay so long? Got to get a breakthrough.
Yes.
I'm going to wrestle with you. I'm going to wrestle with the stuff that goes on in your life. I'm going to wrestle with your busyness. Huh? I'm going to wrestle with your preoccupations. I'm going to wrestle with your other interests so that God can now begin to bring you in to a place that you just desire the heavenly realm. You desire the things of the Rostaya. Amen. That there would be once again women of the Spirit that would be raised up, that was Mariah Woodworth Eder, begin to function and flow in the anointing. Understand, people said that there couldn't be any women preachers. Mariah Woodworth Eder, you talk about, if you were, back when Mariah Woodworth Eder's day, 1920, you were like, you were a heretic if you were a woman preacher. You must be demon possessed. F.F. Bosworth, who wrote the book called Christ the Healer, he stood around and watched all the great people, the Ritchie brothers, Wigglesworth, on and on, John G. Lake. He said no one functioned and operated in the gifts of the Spirit, the miraculous signs and wonders, and the power of the Holy Ghost like Mariah Woodworth Eder. She became known as the mother of Pentecost. Yeah. The champion. She changed the dynamics of the world. One woman. One woman full of the Holy Ghost who suddenly started to stop living as a mere human being and start living in a heavenly realm. She took one of the many things that she did. She was in a meeting one night and there was a baby that was born severely mentally deranged and handicapped, blind, deaf, crippled, just totally paralyzed, couldn't use any of its body at all, deaf. Mute, is hardly much more than just a living organism, non-responsive. 10 years old, she just takes the baby up in her arms. When she took the baby up in her arms, the baby came alive, saw, spoke, took off running under the power of the Holy Ghost. Well, let it be once again.
Yes.
Yes. We don't have to talk about history. Where was CNN in those days? Where was Fox News and everybody in those days? Huh? They weren't around yet. Now it's time for these things to be broadcasted in a way. Huh? Yes. Come on. Now there'd be so many attending physicians. Back in those days, they didn't have attending physicians. That baby would have been just taken care of at home, just like it would be in any third world country. Because that, back in 1920, would be equivalent to third world countries when it comes to most things like that. That baby would just convalesce as you would if you would at home. Papa wants to do it again. He's laboring to do it again. He's laboring to show his power. See, Paul, we call ourselves the Abiding Place Full Gospel Church. But the bottom line of it is, and every church that I love being a part of is Full Gospel Church. But the definition of full gospel in Romans chapter 15, verse 19, is that Paul said, from Jerusalem to Illyricum, he said, I have fully preached the gospel with signs and wonders and the demonstration of the power of the Holy Ghost. When Paul went to preach by himself, he was such a champion in the school of Tyrannus. All of Asia heard of it. Such great signs and wonders and miracles by the space of 2 years that they took handkerchiefs and aprons from his body. It that just touched his body. I'm telling you. The miracles was so great. If this anything just touched Paul's body, they took it no matter how far away they needed to take it. And they laid it upon anyone who was diseased or sick. And the devils went out of them and they were cured. I mean, come on. It's just, that's the way that Father wants it. And when the world around us begins to see the moving of Jesus, we won't have to have, professional music teams anymore. We can get around here and start getting all excited and start dancing and praising the Lord and shouting and have a good time. And nobody's really going to care. Nobody's going to really be offended when the baby that was born with neurotube defect, who was completely unable to function as a human being, is now up walking around and praising like Anna praises. Hey, do you guys see Anna praise? Man, I'm going to tell you right now, as soon as the guitars get in people's hands, her hands go up like this. Just as soon as, look, it's like ready, set, go, right? It's like before she sees that, she's not going to be missing the mark. She's already ready, set, go. She gets those hands up. Did you see her dancing tonight? I mean, come on. People watching little babies to feel that the children's hospital right now begin to fill the church because they know that someone like Jesus, that a people like Jesus is over there, and it doesn't matter what kind of sickness or what kind of disease or what kind of problem or what kind of pain. And they know that, hey, I got this person that lives right down the street from me. I'm telling you, they're just like Jesus. Anytime we take anybody over there, if they're sick, they immediately get healed. The power of God's so in that house that you walk on the yard and you almost can't even walk. It's like you feel like you're drunk. It's hard. You gotta have somebody help hold you up. So you just try to work your way to the front door. Come on, man. These things can happen without a whole bunch of effort. It's just being willing to believe what God said. The only expense is you gotta lose your life. And for so many people, that's just too high of a price to pay. But I'm gonna tell you right now, when you see the treasure. When you see the treasure, people are trying to say, it's too high a price to pay because they never saw the treasure, they never saw the pearl. But as soon as you see the treasure, as soon as you see the pearl, you'll sell all that you have. You might purchase. Hallelujah. The earnest, the eager expectation of all creation is waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. Paul goes on to describe how that all creation is groaning and travailing even until now. But when you look back in the prophet Isaiah, we understand he says that those who are led forth in joy, go forth in joy and are led forth in peace. He says, what about them? He says, the mountains and the hills break forth into singing. Can you see creation? And all the trees in the field begin to clap their hands. Hallelujah. Why? Because somebody's moving in the glory of sonship. Somebody's moving in the glory of the fruits of the Holy Ghost. Somebody has taken a hold of the heavenly life, the Jesus kind of life, the Spirit of God kind of life. They're enjoying it. They're sitting there, and they're just continually at that place, that fountain where the water comes out, and they're not just getting splashed on. They're in the big middle of it, getting soaked. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for great miracles in the place tonight. Father, I thank you that people will begin to be touched by you here in this room tonight. And the powers of darkness that would try to afflict their body and torment them will have to go out in Jesus' name. By the authority of the Word of God, the people that are in this place will begin to believe that what you said is true, that they can speak to disease and sickness like you spoke to that fig tree and it immediately withered. They'll speak to the sickness and the disease and it will go out to them. And it will leave them and will not return to them. Hallelujah. Satan, I command you by the name of Jesus Christ to go into the darkness where you came. In Jesus' name. You foul spirit of hell that would create all kinds of lies in the minds of God's people. You mind-blinding spirit that would hide the beauty and the glory of this life. Oh, the Sivrineshti. Eramosa ningaya namon preneya. Eramosa dere de fiyutushu. Harvanum de piyasherina. Lambambra besusus. Halamambanja siseritafati fiyishi. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Mamamba reste piro. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Ivrevesto romoso rinia pai. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, vrevevesi, renante revevetia. Oh, revesito rotosteia. Thank you, Lord. Everybody just stand with me, will you? Robotom brevescialo. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Ivreduci vranokia. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Brevescio romos. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Berishon remost. Se renaman. Tonight, if you've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, tonight's your chance. Tonight's your opportunity. Hallelujah. Tonight, if you've been plagued with doubt and unbelief, tonight's your opportunity to get a supercharge of faith. Hallelujah. Tonight, if you've been plagued by fear, tonight's your opportunity to get injected with the glory of His divine love. Hallelujah. Cesar Rogene. Hallelujah. Just lift your hands towards heaven.